A lot of what I do also deals with nanomechanics, so I thought it would be a good complement to Eva's talk. So we do nanowire-based magnetic resonance detection and imaging. This is known in the field as MRFM, magnetic resonance force microscopy, so that we'll hear a few talks in this meeting on MRFM. So I'll kick it off. So this is a, for those of you who are familiar with MRFM, this is a slightly different adaptation. It uses many of the same ideas that are used in MRFM, and I'll go over those in a little bit, but with some new twists. So we have, let me just explain this picture, and as I go through the talk, it'll become obvious. This is a nanowire mechanical resonator. It's a single crystal silicon nanowire that's between 50 and 100 nanometers in diameter, about 20 microns long. This is a constriction patterned in a silver film. It's also about 1 to 200 nanometers across, and we pulse very intense currents through this little constriction, which generate magnetic fields. And these magnetic fields allow us to do magnetic resonance and also imaging and also readout to couple the spins to the nanomechanical oscillator. So my interest is in nanoMRI, and specifically to take the techniques of conventional magnetic resonance and nuclear magnetic resonance imaging and spectroscopy and shrink them down to the nano world. So if we look how MRI is applied in the world, right? So the most familiar one is this one. This is a MRI machine. It's basically inductive pickup of nuclear spins, proton spins that are in the body, and the form factor of this MRI coil is matched to the human body, which has a length scale of order a meter. And MRI is very powerful because it can allow imaging down to millimeter or submillimeter scales, even though the size of this object is of order a meter. And how it accomplishes that is through doing spectroscopy on the nuclear spins. It applies magnetic field gradients, which encode spatial location as frequency or phase, and is able to then collect information from the entire spin ensemble from your body and reconstruct an image like this. So you can take the same idea and shrink it to micron scales. It's exactly the same principle. You have a pickup coil, but now you make the filling factor much smaller so that you can look at smaller objects like single cells. And here the length scale is of order a micron. And this is a actively pursued area in commercialization for looking at very small objects with magnetic resonance imaging. So on the millimeter scale, we're dealing with something like 10 to the 19th, 10 to the 20th proton spins per millimeter cubed in a biological sample. We can increase that by a factor of 9 by going to the micron scale just by reducing the form factor, but it kind of stops here because you can't really shrink the coils down much more than this. And so conventional techniques and new techniques have to take over if you want to continue this beautiful ideas for magnetic resonance imaging to the smaller length scales, to the cellular scale, which is 10 microns or 1 to 10 microns, to single virus particles, and even single protein molecules. And here, if you're down to 1 nanometer in size, you've gone roughly 18 orders of magnitude in, you need to make up 18 orders of magnitude in your detection sensitivity to get to the same kind of image that you would have in a clinical MRI machine. So clearly, new techniques have to emerge if you want to look at these samples. But if you could, it would be very powerful because MRI is a non-destructive, chemically specific probe. It allows for fully tomographic, three-dimensional imaging. If you can bring those ideas to these length scale, it would be transformative. So here's a little outline, a brief outline of my talk. I'm going to tell you a little bit about how force-detected magnetic resonance works. Then I'll say a little bit about how we've adapted them to be used with silicon nanowires and the challenges and opportunities that that presents. Then I'll show you some data we took a couple of years ago, to do multidimensional Fourier transform imaging with these techniques. And more recently, very recently, in fact, I've been collaborating with David Corey's group at IQC, specifically Holger Haas, who's in the audience, to develop optimal control pulse sequences for high-resolution spectroscopy on the nanometer scale. So just briefly, this is a beautiful experiment done by Christian Dagan, Martino Poggio, in Dan Rugar's group in about 6 years ago now, to do three-dimensional images of single tobacco mosaic virus particles. They were looking at proton spins in the TMV virus particle, and these particles were attached to the tip of an audio frequency silicon cantilever. And I show this because it demonstrates the ideas of MRFM in a very nice way. So what you need to do MRFM is a gradient source. And for these experiments, the gradient source is a permanent magnet. Here it is. It's a little pillar that's a couple of hundred nanometers wide and tall. And you magnetize this in a very strong external magnetic field. And when it's magnetized, it generates a strong field gradient. And that's the field gradient does two things for you. It generates a force between the spin and the mechanical object, right? The force goes as the magnetic moment of whatever you're trying to detect times the field gradient from the source. And you detect that force using a very small, a very sensitive mechanical cantilever. And the second thing that it does is that it, if you excite the spins with an RF field, as is done here through the use of this little microwire that the that this pillar is patterned on top of, the RF fields can excite magnetic resonance, and the field gradient generated by this coil, by this little tip, confines the magnetic resonance in this what we call the resonance slice. And by moving that resonance slice through the sample, as is done here, you can basically construct the spin density, right? And you can tune yourself to a particular spin. In this case, it's tuned to protons. And you can move this resonance slice in any way you want through that sample, vertically and also laterally. And this then allows you to construct the three-dimensional spin density. And this work demonstrated a spatial resolution that was less than 10 nanometers. And it's still the best nano-MRI work out there. So we wanted to make some improvements on this. And one of the limitations of using audio frequency cantilevers is that you have to get the sample very close to this gradient source. And when you do, you pick up extra sources of fluctuation from charges, from the environment. And these fluctuations have a 1 over F-like character. So you end up hurting your force sensitivity because you have excess noise beyond what's given by just simple thermal fluctuations. This is the best you can do with a mechanical oscillator if you're in the classical limit. This is the temperature of the oscillator. Gamma is the dissipation. And the dissipation is given by the spring constant divided by the frequency times the quality factor of the oscillator. And with some simple analysis, if I assume a circular beam, that goes as the mass of the oscillator times this quantity, which looks like an aspect ratio, which is the radius divided by the length squared, and the quality factor. So if we go to very high frequency oscillators, this was the thought at the time, we can do two things. By going to very high frequencies, we can get out of this low frequency fluctuations near the surface, which dominate the noise that's observed. And the second is that we can make this dashpot, this gamma parameter, quite small. Because if we can make a mechanical system that's very narrow, a very small radius, and very long, and also has a long high Q and a low mass, we can end up with a very small gamma. And this will also improve our force sensitivity. So that was the rationale. And if we look at what might serve as a good candidate for a mechanical system, nanowires are sort of ideal because you can, these are self-assembled. They're not lithographically made. In fact, the growth is quite straightforward. You can grow them in a few hours under the right conditions. You start from a gold catalyst particle, place it into a CVD furnace, introduce silane gas, and the structure self-assembles as a perfect single crystal rod. And you can grow them quite long. So we can make structures that are 50 and 100 nanometers across and up to 20 microns long. And in fact, we do observe mechanical dissipations that are over 100 times lower than the best, at the time, audio frequency cantilevers that can be made. And moreover, you can get very close to a surface, less than 10 nanometers, and stay within the thermal limit of the oscillator. And so these oscillators have resonance frequencies somewhere around a half a megahertz. And that does present some challenges for spin detection. The way spin detection works, right, is that you want to generate a force from the spins that's at resonance with the cantilever. That's at, in our case, half a megahertz. You have a magnetic moment that you're trying to detect. And in the case of the MRFM experiments I showed you, this gradient term was static. And the Z component of the magnetic moment was made time dependent by doing adiabatic reversals at twice the cantilever frequency, which then generated a force that was right at the resonance of the mechanical system. This becomes very challenging when you're trying to do this at megahertz or half a megahertz, hundreds of kilohertz frequencies. So what we decided to do was to actually make the gradient time dependent and apply only a weak time dependence to the magnetic moment to generate a force that was resonant. Another challenge to using silicon nanowires is that when they're grown, they have two modes that are nearly degenerate. And so they're very circular across. Here, this is an as-grown wire. You can see that this half a megahertz wire has a splitting between these two flexural modes of about a kilohertz. And we really want a well-defined mode in one direction and not the other. So what we have done is to deposit, what we do is on the chip that has the wires, we deposit amorphous silicon on either side by shadow evaporation. And then we oxidize, we grow a thermal oxide layer, and then use vapor HF to etch that away to leave us something that is oblate. Right now, this structure does have two well-defined modes. And you can see we use a laser interferometer to pick up the displacement. One mode strongly couples to the interferometer because it's oscillating in that direction, while the other mode is very weak, and we can generate much larger splittings. Now we can really address one mode separate from the other. And you may ask, how is the quality factor affected by doing this kind of processing? The quality factors, once we've done this, can be still quite high, 40,000 at 4 Kelvin. This is comparable to the native quality factor of the oscillator. And we also don't introduce any new impurities. The amount of laser heating that we get when we do displacement detection is of order a Kelvin or so, or less. So it can be quite good. So the experiment looks like this. We have a constriction, a nanometer scale constriction to focus the currents, and a silicon nanowire with the molecules that we want to detect on the tip, and we have a laser interferometer. We can pump very large gradients. We can pump very high current densities through these structures of order 100 milliamps, close to 100 milliamps of time-dependent peak current that can generate very large field gradients. So, current densities. The current densities are quite large, about 10 to the 9th amps per centimeter squared, and field gradients for readout of order 10 to the 6th Tesla per meter, and very, very large rotating fields of order a kilogauss. So we can use these fields for spin readout. This gradient is useful for doing the spin readout. For RF excitation, we have very, very large B1s. So if we apply time-dependent fields right at the resonant frequency of the spins, we can drive them very strongly. So this allows us to do very fast manipulations of the spins as well. And we have highly inhomogeneous fields from the constriction, so we can use that to also do Fourier encoding. The center of the nanowire is really great because the lateral field gradient dBz dx is actually maximum right over the center, so that's good for spin readout. And also the field in the x direction, so for that would be the time-dependent field for doing NMR, is also maximum right over the center. We came up with this technique called MAGIC for doing the spin readout. And the way it works is that we do periodic adiabatic passages on the entire ensemble. So we do that at a rate of maybe a few kilohertz. And every time we do these flips, we also change the phase of the gradient modulation. So now we're modulating the current during readout right at the resonance frequency of the oscillator. So if this was, if we didn't modulate the envelope of the gradient modulation this way, we would have huge pickup, spurious pickup right on resonance from the fact that there's some electric fields generated by this current as well that couple to some stray charge on the nanowire. But this technique avoids that because what it does is it periodically inverts the phase of the gradient modulation. So none of the excitation is resonant. It's all in the sidebands. But by doing these periodic flips in synchrony with these this gradient modulation, all the spin signal ends up on resonance. Another feature of our detection is that we detect not the thermal ensemble, but the statistical fluctuations. And that's because when we're dealing with nanometer scale ensembles, the thermal fluctuations can, the root end statistical polarization of a small ensemble can be larger than the thermal polarization. So for example, if we were at a one Tesla external field, the thermal polarization of protons would have to be for an ensemble of 10 nanometers on a side, we would have to be at 100 millikelvin to match what we would get as the random polarization from the fluctuations themselves. Of course, this brings with it some nice, not so nice things as well. For one thing, we can't coherently average the spin signal because we don't know its amplitude at any given time. We have to average the signal power, and this does cost us signal to noise when our signals become weak compared to the noise. Nonetheless, we can do very sensitive spin detection this way. This is the spin signal from a collection of protons in polystyrene, and here are the properties of the mechanical oscillator that we use for readout. This was done at a very low field, 0.18 Tesla, 7.8 megahertz. So zero frequency here refers to the resonance frequency of the cantilever. So we've demodulated that already. We're just looking at the spin signal that's sitting on top of it. This is the extra excitation we pick up from this MAGIC protocol. The line width here corresponds to the correlation time of these statistical fluctuations, which is of order a second. And what this plot demonstrates is that we can see very small forces, about 2 attonewtons RMS in this case, and near the thermal limit of the oscillator. We can use this technique not only to just read out the spins in a large volume, but also to encode spatial information or frequency information if we wanted to do spectroscopy. So we do that by having periodic readout. So these blocks, these yellow blocks, is this MAGIC protocol where we're reading out the Z component of the spin. And in these purple blocks, we can do some encoding. So this is a Ramsey fringe encoding where we do an adiabatic half passage to create a coherence, which then evolves for some time TE, which we then project back to the z-axis and read out. So if we do these encodings faster than the statistical correlation time, then we can end up with a signal that looks like this, right? And if we analyze the signal, we can extract the correlations we've put in by just calculating the autocorrelation of the signal itself. In this case, the kernel that we've injected through this Ramsey experiment has no spatial dependence. It does everything uniformly on the spins. So that kernel just looks like this, that it's just an oscillating term that goes as the Larmor frequency with an envelope that decays as with a time constant of T2 star. And this is the data for polystyrene. So it has a very short T2 star. Why? Because it's a solid state proton sample, highly dense, high density of protons. The T2 time, T2 star time is somewhere between 10 and 14 microseconds, depending on the experiments we do. The line width is very broad, right? It's something like 80 kilohertz. So it's not very good for spectroscopy. We would have to narrow this if we wanted to get some chemically specific information. We can nonetheless do imaging. So we can, for example, during this free evolution time, apply a gradient pulse. And what that does is it encodes contours of constant Larmor frequency. They pick up different phases. We can then also follow that by a nutation pulse. Remember, there's a very strong gradient in B1 in the sample, and the spins mutate to different angles as you go above the constriction. So that any spins pick up a different nutation phase depending on where they are on these U contours or contours of constant Rabi frequency. So now the kernel that we've injected does have spatial dependence. And this is an SEM of the tip that we used for the imaging. We have polystyrene coating the tip. Here you can see the outline of the silicon nanowire. This is the gold catalyst particle that was grown, that grew the nanowire. And you can see that there's about a 10 or 15 nanometer halo, which is the polystyrene that's coating the tip. And when we do, so this is the raw data, right? Remember, we're working in inverse space. So we collect the raw data by evolving these pulses in both the V contours and U contours. And then we can take this data, do a two-dimensional cosine transform, and end up with the spin density basically in this curvilinear UV coordinate system. But since we know what the constriction looks like, we can simulate what our field distribution is. And that allows us to then transform from this curvilinear system to the rectilinear system. So now you can see the tip. This is an MRI of the tip. This region of suppressed spin density is because of the gold catalyst particle. And we get the proton density with about 10 nanometer spatial resolution at the tip. Okay? Of course, the spatial resolution gets worse because the gradients get lower as you go further back. But within about a 50 nanometer volume of this constriction, we have good gradients and we get fairly high spatial resolution. And this is a simulation showing what you get just from the image. So now we've gone beyond that to do recently to do spectroscopy. And now what we want to do is to use these large gradients near the constriction to actually to do things like dipolar decoupling and enhance our lines. And this is where collaboration with Holger Haas and David Corey's group comes in. We've been working quite hard on this for the last few months. This is another experiment where, again, we're dealing with polystyrene. Here you see the spin signal, just there's no encoding whatsoever. The integrated signal is about 35 attonewtons squared. Knowing our gradients, that's about 2.4 Bohr magnetons of fully polarized spin. So a very thin sample right at the tip of this 100 nanometer wide silicon nanowire. This is drawn to scale. The constriction we used in this experiment was 150 nanometers across. These contours refer to Rabi frequencies. So we have very large Rabi fields of about 1.2 megahertz near 50 nanometers away from the constriction. And it falls off to about 6/10 of a megahertz, about 150 nanometers back. We can Rabi encode, so we can apply nutation pulses again, and we can get the Rabi field dispersion of the sample. And this is the data showing that. You can see the fields, the frequencies extend from 1.2 megahertz down to about 600 kilohertz. Now, this is very challenging because if you want to apply hard pulses to do anything like your conventional pulse sequences, it would be impossible because you can't apply a pi over 2 pulse or a pi pulse when you have a factor 2 variation in your Rabi field. So this is where the optimal control ideas come in. And optimal control was introduced in NMR in 2005 and is, I think, quickly picking up speed. And the way it works is the following. If you have a control field, you can discrete. So this is there are many versions of optimal control. This is called gradient ascent pulse engineering, or GRAPE. And it basically, you can start from some initial state and evolve to a target state by varying the amplitude of these control parameters. Okay, and what this algorithm allows you to do is it varies these control parameters independently. So you discretize your pulse into many, many segments. And it varies the amplitude of both the in-phase and quadrature, your I and Q signals going into your mixer. And to basically guide your density matrix from some initial state to a final state. And so it calculates this overlap between your density matrix and your final state, and it maximizes that overlap. And what's so great about this is that you can design whatever unitary operation you want, and over a very large dispersion of B1 or B0 or instrument transients or nonlinear response, you can handle all of this through some pulse that is optimized for your conditions. Moreover, Corey's group has added this piece, which is average Hamiltonian theory into OCT. Not only can you just evolve to a desired target, but you can also engineer average Hamiltonian properties into whatever unitary you're applying to the spin system. So for example, this is a pulse that lasts 7 microseconds. This is the in-phase and quadrature component that's optimized in the lab in the rotating frame. And you see it looks like a complete jumbled mess, but it's designed to hit the range of B1s that I showed you that are for this particular experiment. It achieves a 180-degree pulse, so it's a pi pulse. It can do that it's designed to do that about any axis. And at the same time, it averages the dipolar Hamiltonian to zero. So it does dynamical decoupling at the same time. This is the pulse applied to spin starting from the z-axis. We apply n of these pulses. You can see we've applied 1, 3, 6, 9, so on, out to 60. You can see a decay here. That's due to the fact that there are some imperfections in the pulse. This is the characterization of the pulse, where we start from spin in the x direction, and then we interrogate its projection onto x, y, or z through this kind of sequence. So these are the matrix elements of this ideal pulse. You see, for an ideal pulse, you have no off-diagonal elements. But for us, we do have some off-diagonal elements. But nonetheless, it does pretty well. Okay, and it does it for all the spins across this B1 dispersion. We can account for some of those imperfections by applying this kind of pi, minus pi, kind of like in a CPMG sequence. And this corrects for some of the over-rotations that we get. When we do that and we apply these back to back, we can extend that 10 microsecond coherence to nearly a second by doing dipolar decoupling at the same time that we're doing these pi rotations. We've done two other controls here. We've done the same 7 microsecond pulse, but we've excluded on purpose in the optimization any dipolar decoupling. So we have some dipolar decoupling. Maybe the dipolar Hamiltonian gets averaged to a half or a quarter of its value, but most of it is still there. And if that's the case, the decay happens under a millisecond. Likewise, we can take the dipolar average pulse and make it much longer, 35 microseconds. It also decays very fast. Now, because the higher order terms in the dipolar Hamiltonian start to enter when you make the length of the pulse much longer than T2 star. So again, the coherence dies very quickly. Another pulse that we've worked with is a pulse that does dipolar averaging at the same time that allows you to pick up chemical shift. So it gives you the Z Hamiltonian, but scaled. In this case, it's scaled by 1/4. So here we're applying this pulse, so consecutive pulses out to 2.5 milliseconds. You can see these oscillations. There's some beating in there as well. I'll tell you what that is in a minute. This is the Fourier transform of the signal, where you see that the resonance, where we have the resonance frequency is at 60.068 megahertz, when we do the transform here to the laboratory frame, when we're applying the pulse, we're purposely detuning it from resonance, and we're making it 60.128 to see these oscillations. These oscillations should come in at 1/4 of the frequency difference between this frequency and the resonance frequency. And if we plot that frequency as for three different resonance offsets that we've applied, we see that it extrapolates to a resonance frequency of 60.068. This is our actual resonance frequency with an error bar of 2.7 kilohertz. And the scaling is not quite a quarter, but it's close. It's 0.227. So how am I doing on time?
No one is. 5 minutes.
5 minutes. Good.
If you want 10 minutes.
Okay. And so let me tell you what that beating is about. I'm almost done. This is the actual lab frame simulation of that pulse that we just applied. You can also see beating in the pulse. And this is the data for the same resonance offset. So it's quite close. And what we believe the what this beating is caused by is the fact that when this pulse was optimized, this is the actual scaling as a function of B1 that was achieved in the optimization process. So it wasn't quite optimized well enough, right? It's not a quarter across the entire B1 range. At this low end, it becomes closer to about 0.3. And we believe that it's this variation in the optimization as a function of B1 that's causing this beating. But it shows up both in the simulation and in the data. This is something that can be fixed in the future. This was our first attempt of applying OCT to do spectroscopy or to do control of spins. And we've learned quite a lot in these experiments. And one of the things that we learned is that, you know, our B1 fields are so large, in fact, our B1 fields are of a couple of hundred gauss, 280 gauss, that the Bloch-Siegert effect is an important thing to consider. The Bloch-Siegert effect is basically the deviation from when you transform into the lab frame, you pick up, you know, you drop your counter-rotating, you make the rotating wave approximation, and that breaks down. And the first order correction to that is called the Bloch-Siegert effect. And with a resonance frequency of 60 megahertz, the B1 fields are sufficiently strong that it causes problems like over-rotation when you apply a pi pulse. And it may even account for some of the structure that we see here. So the way to get around that is to really do the optimization not in the rotating frame, but directly in the lab frame. With grape, that's very difficult because you have to discretize this pulse to many, many segments, hundreds of segments. And if you, that's only in the lab frame. If you have to make that discretization even finer if you want to do this with the actual, you know, 60 megahertz signal. And a much better basis for doing this is not this sort of discrete basis, but a continuous basis. So people work with, for example, Fourier basis, where you pick, let's say, 5 tones you want to work with and say, now optimize the parameters, amplitudes, and phases of these 5 tones that are within my excitation bandwidth to give me the desired unitary, and so on. So these approaches can be applied, and that's probably what we're going to be working on in the future. But we believe this has a lot of, you know, applications for not only what we're doing, but also for people doing NV centers, I think, would benefit from some of these ideas. Let me just end here. So I hope I've demonstrated that radio frequency silicon nanowire mechanical oscillators greatly enhance force sensitivity and by reducing the dissipation and allow us to do some very sensitive measurements. And this ability to generate these intense time-dependent magnetic fields has been actually quite interesting, because we are now at the point where we can generate 10 to the 6 Tesla per meter field gradients. That was the last data set that I showed you. The peak gradients there were 1 by 10 to the 6th. So we're really, you know, creeping up on what conventional, you know, ferromagnets can do. But moreover, it allows us to control these fields in time. And that gives you a lot of control, you know, a lot of opportunities for doing spectroscopy and imaging on the nanoscale. And so the people that I like to thank for this, John Nickel was the first student in my group who started this. He developed this magic detection protocol and also did all the work on Fourier imaging. My current student is also in the audience, Bill Rose, and David Corey's student, Holger Haas, have worked really, really well together in the last few months to develop some of these ideas for optimal control. Angela Chen and Tyler Neighbor, Tyler's also in the audience, have done a lot of nice work on nanofabrication and making these constrictions for us. So thank you for your attention.
Can you make three-dimensional pictures in your setup?
Well, yes. Just a single constriction allows you to get two spatial directions. if you make a different structure, we've talked about this for a while, but haven't had the time to do it yet, but like a T structure, basically, then you can apply gradients in two orthogonal directions. And then you should be able to use the Raabe field, the gradient in the Raabe field as the third gradient, and to get full three-dimensional imaging.
That way. Well,
moving the cantilever, I think, could also work. But as if you want to do Fourier imaging, and if you want to just an efficient way to do it, then holding the cantilever still and just pulsing the fields is much simpler.
So given these optimal control ideas, I assume that somehow lets you kind of narrow the spectral bandwidth of the signals you get?
Yeah, so.
And that would then go directly into your imaging resolution, is that right? And what impact would that have?
So we can do several things. You can use an OCT pulse to, for example, selectively invert a certain region of B1 if you're doing imaging. So you can say, I want to target B1s from this value to that value and do a pi pulse on those. It allows you to do, so one of the things that we're excited about is to do spatially resolved spectroscopy, where you can actually measure chemical shifts maybe down to 100 hertz and see real chemically specific information, but spatially resolved. And to do that, you need to be able to average this dipolar Hamiltonian. So there's a couple of different ways of doing that. One approach is this one pulse does it all kind of scheme, where you have one pulse that does the, gives you some scaled chemical shift along with the averaging, along with the unitary, all in one package. Or you can have pulses that do like a pi over 2 pulse or a pi pulse on your ensemble and build up something like a magic echo sequence. And a magic echo sequence allows you to then do homonuclear decoupling. And then it has gaps in the pulse sequence. And in these gaps, you can apply gradients. And then now you can do also higher spatial resolution imaging by narrowing the line. So I think you can use it for a number of different things. Yeah.
I seem to recall that you had like a third gate on your setup to try to sort of cancel away the electrostatic interactions with the cantilever, maybe from the laser charging up the nanowire.
Well, there are, so.
Can you remind me how that works?
Sure. So we do have gates, and so let me just jump to that, like these top gates. So those gates basically tune the amount of charge that's on the wire. So there's a I didn't really have time to get into all the fabrication steps, but we actually strip the native oxide on the surface, and we grow about a 2 nanometer thick thermal oxide on the surface, and that's very important. So there are charge traps that fluctuate, and if you can't electrostatically access those, then you're just stuck with them in your experiment. So by having this thermal oxide layer, it actually introduces an interfacial charge that you can drain or control with an external gate. That's what we do when we apply a gate bias between the constriction and the tip itself. And that tunes the minimum. We can talk more about that. But there are charge fluctuations that you can basically tune out doing that kind of thing. These gates allow you to actually actuate. Those top gates you can use to drive the nanowire if you want to self-oscillate or damp or something like this.
So you just tune them to the minimum dissipation and then you leave them, or you're doing something?
We tune them and leave them, yeah. That's right.
How does the failure crystal trend density vary as a function of the AC frequency? So I assume those are tested at hundreds of kilohertz.
Yeah. I can't give you a very good answer. We've tested them. We haven't done really any kind of systematics. We've tested them as low as something like 50 kilohertz, and we've gone up to 60 megahertz. And at these frequencies, they seem to do fine. We have blown them out. They're not impossible to blow out. So with enough current, you can make anything blow out. But so we have to take a little bit. We have to be careful when we're working with them to not exceed a certain value. And finding that experimentally is a bit tricky.
How much current do you send for these?
So in the experiments that we've done, the readout currents, so this was at 300 kilohertz, was at 70 milliamps peak. Yeah.
So you should have plot where you had very little surface-induced friction as you approach the surface. So what is the frequency jitter in those measurements, or how stable is your resonance frequency?
Yeah, so very good questions. And actually, the guy behind you is the one to ask, because he's done all of it. So what we find, this is the beauty of having this thin thermal oxide layer. We can't find the sort of minimum if you don't have that. There's no control. What we find is that, in fact, the dissipation always stays narrow, meaning if you do the autocorrelation of the noise, you will find the intrinsic noise. But the jitter is what kills you, right? So the jitter you minimize to a very, very large extent by doing this. And the jitter becomes much narrower than the line width. So the jitter gets quite narrow, but still not good enough. So what we do is we apply a feedback on the actual gate voltage. We have a small satellite peak that we drive off to the side, and we monitor that, and then we lock that up to keep the frequency steady. And if you do that, you can run the experiments for months, and it's just locked on. Yeah.
Any more questions, Dan?
So when we were, in early days, but when we were exploring cantilevers and non-contact friction, we found that having gold on the end of the cantilever was good in the reduced charge fluctuation noise, but it did have eddy current noise when we brought it close to the magnets. Mm-hmm. And you always have a little gold particle.
These don't actually. You know, when we do this sort of mode shaping, so the thermal oxide is grown at 1,000 degrees, so the gold will just simply move. So prior to doing that, we actually ion mill the gold particles off. So there's just bare silicon. Yeah.
One technical question that should not be the last. Why magnesium oxide?
Why magnesium oxide? So the initial motivation, which weren't realized in these experiments, but we're working on now, is to grow epitaxial layers. So my original idea was the following. So if you make very narrow bridges of gold, so I don't know if you know this work, but right, there's quantized conductance work where you take two gold banks and then there's a single atomic bridge, right, that gaps these. If you ask, what's the current density going through that single atomic layer or bridge, it's 10 to the 11th amps per centimeter squared. The reason why it can sustain such high current densities is because it's atomically perfect, right? So if you allow for scattering to occur outside this narrow region, then you should be in a situation that's good, right? That the constriction can sustain a high current density. So why don't we make the electron mean free path long and make the constriction small? So we put silver on MgO because silver is a good, very good metal. And MgO, between the surface of MgO and silver, is supposed to grow epitaxial. And of course, we didn't realize epitaxial growth yet. We have demonstrated that we can grow epitaxial layers, but we haven't really worked with them yet. We haven't really patterned them. So these are polycrystalline. So we said, OK, well, maybe MgO isn't so important for these. But it turns out that if you pattern these on silicon, the current density goes down by a factor of 2 or 3. From what it is on MgO. So there's still some nice properties of that interface. We hope to make it even nicer because these are polycrystalline. These are just deposited in an e-beam evaporator. But with real epitaxial films, they may even perform better than this.
Thank you very much.
Sure.